Our today's session is about Euclidean domains. So, about Euclidean domain. इससे पहले कि हम Euclidean domain को discuss करें, हम कुछ concept recall करते हैं. We know that an integral domain is a commutative ring. Let's recall that definition. Integral domain. A commutative ring or with identity means with multiplicative identity, with identity is called integral domain. If R does not contain zero divisors. Zero divisors. So this is definition of integral domain. I have just recalled it. We know this definition very well. Already, let's define the concept of divisibility. So, divisibility. ये एक ऐसा concept है जिसे आप primary school से जानते हैं. So, let R be an integral domain. And let A, B are two elements which belong to this integral domain R. Then we say that B divides A. B divides A. We write it in symbols, We write B divides A. This slash means divides. So B divides A if there exists C belonging to R such that A is equal to BC. A is equal to B multiplied with C. Let's see a few examples. In Z, the integral domain of integers, four divides 12. The reason is because there exists an integer and that is 3 in Z such that 12 is equal to 4 multiplied by 3. 4 multiplied by 3. Similarly, we can see that 5 divides 20. The reason is very simple, because there exists 4 belonging to Z such that 20 is equal to 5 multiplied by 4. And similarly, you can see that 3 divides 3, because there exists 1 belonging to Z such that 3 is equal to 3 multiplied with 1. And similarly, 3 divides minus 3. And reason is simple, because there exists minus 1 belonging to Z such that minus 3 is equal to 3 multiplied with minus 1. And similarly, we can see that minus 3 also divides 3. And the reason is because there exists 1 belonging to Z such that 3 is equal to minus 3 multiplied with 1. So this is concept of divisibility. We say that B divides A if there exists an element C in the ring or in the integral domain such that A is equal to B multiplied with C. So I repeat it. B divides A means there exists an element C in the ring R such that A is equal to B multiplied with C. So this is the concept of divisibility. By B divides A, we mean that there exists C belonging to the integral domain such that A is equal to B multiplied with C. So this is the concept of divisibility. So having said that, now we come to the concept of Euclidean domain. But before defining Euclidean domain, let's have a definition about a very familiar concept you already know, and that is highest common factor. You call it adyazam when you are in your primary class. So highest common factor we write it HCF. Some books write it as greatest common divisor or greatest common divisor. Or GCD. But we will call it HCF or highest common factor. In Urdu, you call it adyazam. you can go back to your school time books and find this particular concept for revision. So let's see what highest common factor is. The definition goes as follows. Definition: let R be an integral domain and let A, B are two elements belonging to this particular integral domain. Then an element D belonging to R, then an element D belonging to R is called highest common factor of A and B. Is called highest common factor HCF or HCF of A and B if we have two conditions. First condition is D must divide A and D must divide B. So this is the first condition. And secondly, if there is some other element D dash, if D dash divides A and D dash divides B for some D dash belonging to the integral domain R, then D dash must divide D as well. So these are the two conditions. First, D is highest common factor of A and B if D divides A as well as D divides B. And secondly, if there is some other element of the integral domain which divides A and B, then that particular element D dash must also divide D. If this happens, then D becomes highest common factor. We usually write A comma B order pair. In fact, this is just a notation. We use this particular notation in order to represent the highest common factor, which is D in this case. So if D is highest common factor of A and B, then we denote this highest common factor by this particular symbol. So this is in fact just a notation. Let's see a few examples. These examples are from your school times. So consider the integral domain of integers, and let's take these two numbers or these two integers from this particular integral domain of integers 12 and 20. Then you know that the highest common factor of 12 and 20, in fact, this means that an element of Z which divides 12 and 20 both, and that is the highest one. That is the highest one. And it is very easy to see that highest common factor of 12 and 20 is 4. 4 is the highest common factor of 12 and 20. Reason is this, because 1st condition, 4 divides 12 and 4 divides 20. And secondly, if some other element of Z divides 4 and some other element of Z divides 12 and 20, then that element should divide 4 as well, because since 2 divides 12 and 2 divides 20, then we note that two divides 4 as well. So if there is some other element of Z which divides 12 and 20, that element should divide this particular element 4. So 4 is the highest element of Z which divides 12 and 20 both. If there is some other element of Z which divides 12 and 20, then that particular element would divide 4 as well. So 4 is the highest divisor of 12 and 20, or highest common factor. So this is an example. Next, we can recall a method of finding HCF from your school times. So let's discuss that method from your school time. Let's take it as an example. Find HCF of 18 and 48. तो आपको याद होगा स्कूल टाइम पर अगर आपको कोई ऐसी एक्सरसाइज दी जाए तो आप यूं करते थे कि जो बड़ा नंबर है उस नंबर को आप छोटे नंबर के साथ डिवाइड करने का एक प्रोसेस शुरू करते थे, जिसे एल्गोरिदम कहते हैं. So we divide 48 by 18. So 18 twos are 36 and remainder is 12. फिर आपको याद होगा आप ये जो इससे पहले डिवाइजर था उस डिवाइजर को आप इस रिमाइंडर से डिवाइड करते हैं 18. So 12 ones are 12 and remainder is 6. अब फिर आप इस रिमाइंडर के साथ इससे पहले जो डिवाइजर था उसे आप डिवाइड करेंगे. So you will divide now 12 with 6. 6 twos are 12 and we get 0 at the end. Therefore आपको याद होगा कि आपके पास HCF जो है 18 और 48 का ये वाला नंबर आता है जिसके साथ आखिर में आपने डिवाइड किया था 6. सो दिस वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट प्रोसेस टू नोट. फर्स्ट स्टेप में आप बड़े नंबर को छोटे नंबर से डिवाइड करते हैं. सो आप इसके साथ डिवाइड कर रहे हैं और 12 आपस रिमाइंडर आता है. फिर जो आपका रिमाइंडर आता है वो डिवाइजर बन जाता है और 18 को आप इस रिमाइंडर से डिवाइड करते हैं. उसके बाद रिमाइंडर आपका 6 आता है और ये 6 जो है ना ये फिर इसके बाद डिवाइजर बन जाता है. 12 को आप फिर 6 से डिवाइड करते हैं और ये काम उस वक्त तक आप करते रहते हैं जब तक आपके पास remainder zero नहीं आ जाता. So having said that, so this is the process of finding highest common factor of two elements of integral domain Z. और ये बात आपने स्कूल टाइम पर सीखी हुई है. सो हैविंग रिपीटेड दिस प्रोसेस, लेट्स कम टू अ डेफिनेशन, एंड दैट इज डेफिनेशन ऑफ, इनफैक्ट दिस इज डेफिनेशन ऑफ यूक्लिडियन डोमेन. सो यूक्लिडियन डोमेन, so let's define that. An integral domain R is called a Euclidean domain and integral domain ki definition humne recall ki hai, this is a commutative ring with identity which does not contain zero divisors. So an integral domain R is called Euclidean domain Euclid एक ग्रीक मैथमेटिशियन था, इसे उर्दू में अक्लीदस कहते हैं. आपने शायद सुना होगा ये लफ्ज, उर्दू में हम इसे अक्लीदस कहते हैं. एक ग्रीक मैथमेटिशियन था, यूनानी मैथमेटिशियन. सो एन इंटीग्रल डोमेन आर इज कॉल्ड Euclidean domain if two any element of R which is non-zero, we can assign a non-negative integer non-negative integer means 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, so positive integers including 0, these are non-negative integers. So we can assign a non-negative integer. इस non-negative integer को हम phi a से represent कर लेते हैं, phi a, such that दो conditions हैं. First condition तो ये है कि phi a has to be less than or equal to phi of product of two elements a and b for all a b belonging to the integral domain R, and a and b have to be non-zero. And second condition is for any a b belonging to the integral domain R where b is not equal to 0, there must exist two elements q and r in the integral domain R such that a is equal to b q plus r where phi of R is less than phi of B or R is equal to 0. I think we must have less than or equal to phi of B or R is equal to 0. बड़ा सिंपल सा कंसेप्ट है, आप इसे पहले आपसे जानते भी हैं, काफ़ी प्रैक्टिस भी आपको इस चीज़ की। मैं आपको एग्जांपल से समझाता हूँ कि आप कंसीडर करें जेड द इंटीग्रल डोमेन ऑफ इंटीजर्स, कंसीडर जेड द इंटीग्रल डोमेन ऑफ इंटीजर्स। देन सबसे पहली बात तो ये नोट कीजिए कि फॉर एनी ए बिलोंगिंग टू जेड, फाई ए जो हमने फाई ऊपर जिक्र किया है, फाई ए के माने हैं एब्सोल्यूट वैल्यू ऑफ ए, यानी कि अगर ए पॉजिटिव है तो इसको ए ही रहने दें, अगर ए नेगेटिव है तो इसको पॉजिटिव कर दीजिए। तो इसे व्हाट फाई ए मीन्स फॉर जेड, ए इज इक्वल टू बी क्यू प्लस आर से मतलब भी आप जानते हैं कि फर्ज कीजिए कि हम ए की वैल्यू ले लें, लेट ए इज इक्वल टू से 39 एंड सपोज बी इज इक्वल टू 4। अब ये नोट कीजिए कि आप जो प्रोसेस किया करते हैं वो ये है कि आप 39 को 4 से डिवाइड करने का प्रोसेस इस तरह से होता है कि नाइन टाइम्स 4 इज इक्वल टू 36 एंड रिमाइंडर आपके पास यहाँ 3 आ जाता है। देयरफॉर वी कैन राइट थर्टी नाइन इज इक्वल टू 4 इंटू 9 प्लस 3, सो 39 इज इक्वल टू 4 मल्टीप्लाइड विद 9 एंड देन प्लस 3। तो आप नोट कीजिए कि ये इतनी में यही चीज़ है, ए इज 39, बी is 4 and q is 9 and r is 3. This is what you call, in fact you call it quotient, you call it remainder, this is dividend, this is divisor. If you remember these things, this is called quotient. This is called dividend. This is called divisor and this is called remainder. This is why we write this as q. So 39 is equal to 4 multiplied by 9 with plus 3. 3 is the remainder. So a is equal to b q plus r, so this is remainder r, this is q, this is r, then this is a and this is b. So a is equal to b q plus r, b q plus r, and those conditions as far as phi is concerned, since we have chosen positive integers, so these conditions are automatically satisfied. Anyway, I have taken this example just to recall your concepts from your school level, so these are the things you already know. So if we are given two elements from the integral domain, we can find two elements q and r in the integral domain such that a is equal to bq plus r, where phi r is less than or equal to phi b, or r is equal to 0. So having said that, let's come to a theorem. And theorem says that let R be a Euclidean domain and A, B are two elements of R, where A and B are not equal to 0, these are non-zero elements, then A and B have an HCF, highest common factor. I think I must write N. Then A and B have highest common factor, which can be expressed as AU plus BV for UV belonging to R. देखा अगर हमें यूक्लिडियन डोमेन R के कोई दो एलिमेंट्स दे दिए जाएं तो उन दो एलिमेंट्स का हाईएस्ट कॉमन फैक्टर निकाला जा सकता है और उस हाईएस्ट कॉमन फैक्टर को इस शक्ल में लिखा जा सकता है. क्योंकि हमने हाईएस्ट कॉमन फैक्टर को रिप्रेजेंट करने के लिए ये नोटेशन का फैसला किया था. So highest common factor of A and B is equal to AU plus BV. This is what we have to establish. So let's come to the proof. So for proof, our first step is going to be we have to define, in fact, we, since R is an interior domain, therefore function or assignment phi is automatically there. So let's note this particular thing. Since R is an integral domain, so since R is a Euclidean domain, therefore, because definition of Euclidean domain says that there is an assignment phi which has certain conditions. So, since R is a Euclidean domain, therefore, we have an assignment phi such that the condition we have already discussed, such that first condition is phi A is less than or equal to phi A B for all A B belonging to or A B are non-zero. This is the condition which was given in the definition. And secondly, for any AB belonging to R, b has to be non-zero, b not equal to zero. There must exist q and r belonging to r such that a is equal to bq plus r, where phi r is less than phi b, or r is equal to zero. So this is in fact definition of Euclidean domain. So having said that, now we choose two elements of the ring R. So let AB belong to R. Such that phi A is greater than or equal to phi B. So let's take two elements of the Euclidean domain R. Then, because of our conditions which we have repeated in our first step, there must exist Q1 and R1 in the Euclidean domain R such that we are going to use this particular condition, such that A is equal to BQ1 plus R1, where note that let me correct my this inequality. It is just less than, not less than or equal to. Let me correct it in my previous definition as well. Phi R is less than phi B. So please note it. This is a correction. Phi R is less than phi B. So this is in fact definition. So A is equal to BQ1 plus R1, where phi R1 is less than phi B. This is because of this condition, phi R is less than phi B, where phi R1 is less than phi B. Now let me recall the process of finding HCF from our school drawing. Remember that this is a divisor, and when we divide, we obtain a remainder 12, and then 12 becomes a divisor, and 12 divides 18, we obtain a remainder 6. Then 6 becomes divisor, and we divide 12 with 6, and then, so note that the remainder becomes divisor. It is very important thing to note that in the process of finding HCF, the remainder becomes divisor. In this case, you can see that R1 is remainder. So in our next step, R1 will become divisor. In this case, B is a divisor. B is a divisor. R1 is a remainder. Now R1 will become divisor. R1. And R1 will divide B. B. R1. And then we will have some, say it Q2 quotient, and then plus remainder, let's call this remainder R2. And in this case, we will have phi of R2 is less than phi of R1. Phi of R1 is less than phi of B. Now phi of R2 is less than phi of R1. So phi of R2 is less than phi of R1. And therefore, now this remainder will become divisor. This remainder, R2 will become divisor, and R2 will divide R1. R1 is equal to R2, and let's write quotient as Q3, and then plus R3. And in this case, we would have phi R3 is less than phi R2. And next, you can easily see that now this remainder will become divisor. This remainder will become divisor R3, and this R3 will divide R2. So R2 will come here. R3, let's take quotient as R4, Q4 plus R4, and condition is phi R4 is less than phi R3. And so on, we keep on doing that. And we keep on doing that until we obtain remainder as 0. This is the process you already know from your school time. जब आप HCF निकाल रहे होते हैं तो आप उस वक्त तक ये प्रोसेस जारी रखते हैं एल्गोरिदम का, जब तक आपको रिमाइंडर ज़ीरो नहीं मिल जाता. सो वी कीप ऑन डूइंग दैट अनटिल वी ऑब्टेन. हम लास्ट टर्म लिख लेते हैं, Rn-2 इज इक्वल टू, आप इसे नोट कर लीजिए कि यहाँ पर R2 है तो यहाँ पर 3 है, इससे एक ज़्यादा. तो ये Rn-2 है तो यहाँ पर Rn-1 होगा, इसमें एक जमा कर दीजिए. फिर यहाँ पर अगर आपके पास R3 है तो यहाँ पर Q4 है, तो यहाँ इसे एक ज़्यादा. तो यहाँ Rn-1 है तो यहाँ पर इसमें एक जमा कीजिए, यहाँ पर Qn आ जाएगा. और अगर यहाँ Q4 है तो यहाँ पर R4 है, तो यहाँ पर Qn है, तो यहाँ पर Rn होगा. और कंडीशन आप बड़ी आसानी से लिख सकते हैं, वे phi Rn यानी कि रिमाइंडर पर phi की वैल्यू इज लेस देन डिवाइजर पर phi की वैल्यू से phi Rn-1. और इसके बाद की टर्म जो है वो होगी, ये अगर R1 था तो ये R2 है, ये Rn-2 है, तो इसके बाद एक आगे चलिए तो ये आ जाएगा Rn-1, एंड दिस इज इक्वल टू, अब R2 से R3 तो इसमें एक बढ़ाएंगे, तो Rn-1 में एक बढ़ाएंगे तो ये Rn हो जाएगा. और ये R3 है तो Q4 है, तो ये Rn है, तो ये Qn+1 होगा. अब इस प्रोसेस ने कहीं ना कहीं ख़त्म होना है जाकर, तो हम इसी स्टेज पर इस प्रोसेस को ख़त्म कर लेते हैं. और हम नोट कर लेते हैं कि यहाँ जो रिमाइंडर है जो कि एक्चुअली Rn+1 बनना था, वो हमारे पास 0 है. सो एक तो हम इसे नोट कर लेते हैं, इसके में जरूर पेश आएगी आगे जाकर, वी कॉल इट 1. और एक हम इसे नोट कर लेते हैं, वी कॉल इट 2. और एक हम इसे नोट कर लेते हैं, ये मैं लास्ट वन है, इस वी कॉल इट 3. तो हमने दरअसल डिवीजन एल्गोरिदम यूज़ किया है. अब यहाँ पर Rn+1 के 0 आने से मुतलिक हम एक रिमार्क हम लिख लेते हैं कि लेट्स कॉल इट रिमार्क. तो ये बात नोट कीजिए कि phi b जो है वो phi r वन से बड़ा है, 5b इज ग्रेटर देन 5r1। यहाँ इज इक्वल टू मैं गलती से वहाँ लगा रहा था, इसलिए मैंने इसको ठीक कर दिया था, बिकॉज इट हैज़ टू बी स्ट्रिक्टली ग्रेटर देन, डेफिनेशन के मुताबिक हमने डिफाइन किया था। सो 5b इज ग्रेटर देन 5r1 एंड 5r1 इज ग्रेटर देन 5r1 इज ग्रेटर देन 5r2 एंड 5r2 इज ग्रेटर देन 5r3 एंड 5r3 इज ग्रेटर देन 5r4 एंड देन ग्रेटर देन, इसके बाद आप इस तरह चलते रहिए। अब ये नोट कीजिए कि ये जो सीक्वेंस है इसमें 5b सबसे बड़ा है, उसके बाद 5r1 छोटा है, 5r2 छोटा है, 5r3 छोटा है, 5r4 छोटा है, तो ये स्ट्रिक्टली डिक्रीजिंग सीक्वेंस है, स्ट्रिक्टली डिक्रीजिंग सीक्वेंस ऑफ नॉन नेगेटिव इंटीजर्स। तो जब आप नॉन नेगेटिव इंटीजर्स का स्ट्रिक्टली डिक्रीजिंग सीक्वेंस लेंगे तो इसने लाजमी जाके आखिर में ज़ीरो होना है। सो जस्ट वी जस्ट नोट दैट